Before this video gets started, I want to give a big shout out to one of my biggest channel supporters, Sam Lang from Peavey, Missouri. He's a huge NASCAR nut like I am, and is a big fan of Mark Martin. And while this video may talk about Mark a little bit, don't worry, Sam. That Mark Martin video is coming out sooner or later. Anyways, thank you for 800 subscribers, and thank you for watching. With the name of the company gone to drive for Hendrick, it was up to the remainder of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated to pick up the pieces and keep the legacy going for 2008. And honestly, with the merger of a new team, everything seemed hopeful at first. In the midst of the 2007 season, DEI merged with newly rebranded Ginn Racing, formerly known as MB2 Motorsports. With it, they brought veteran Mark Martin and young upstart Eric Almirola. The entire kerchuckle that was this merger could be made into its own video, but Brock Beard and Slap Shoes already did that. If you want all the nitty-gritty details, go watch their video after this one. Needless to say, by the time they were bought out by DEI, their ship was already halfway sunk with no way of saving it. With the purchase, they acquire the 01 Army car, but Ginn's 13 and 14 cars are unaccounted for. Mark Martin and Eric Almirola will swap in and out of the 01 car throughout the season, since Mark just wants to run a part-time schedule. By 2008, with Dale Jr. gone, it would be up to Martin Truex to be the flag bearer for DEI. But like I said in part one, this is where the team dies. There was a ton of optimism for DEI coming into 2008. The team was the biggest it's ever been, with four cars in their roster. Martin Truex Jr. would continue driving the 1. Paul Menard would field the 15 car and brought big sponsorship dollars with his father's company. The Army sponsorship would be brought over to Jr.'s old 8 car, which would be driven by Mark Martin and Eric Almirola, who were both on a part-time schedule. And lastly, the new guy, Reagan Smith, would be behind the wheel of the 01 car. Unfortunately though, the optimism was short-lived, and this is where the whole operation starts to truly fall apart. The causes are all over the place, so there's really not one clear reason. It was a lot of things. First of all, Junior leaving for Hendrick was by far the biggest gut punch. Therese's greed, the fact that literally nobody was signed for DEI in 2009 except Truex and Reagan Smith, and finally the two killing blows, one which likely leads to another. The 2008 financial meltdown, and the merger with Chip Ganassi Racing. Originally known as Sapco, famed IndyCar owner Chip Ganassi took ownership and rebranded the team, reopening its doors in the Cup Series in 2001 as Chip Ganassi Racing. In just their first year, they had already proven that they could be competitive in NASCAR. And by 2008, the team was less than a decade old, but it already had a handful of wins and a near championship run with the likes of Sterling Marlin and their flagship number 40 Dodge. But much like Dale Earnhardt Incorporated's one and Steve Park, it would be the cause of injury to its star driver, one which they would never fully recover. Now 8 seasons deep into NASCAR, the team is doing less than optimal. Then, along comes DEI and Teresa Earnhardt. On November 12th of 2008, the day before the second to last race of the season, it was announced that DEI and Chip Ganassi would merge to form Earnhardt-Ganassi Racing. Starting in 2009, the team would see a sizable overhaul. Gone were the Dodges that Ganassi had aided bringing back into NASCAR, and in were the Chevys, with engines being built by ECR. And the team's new roster looked like this. Martin Truex would remain holding the flag for the 1 car which was brought over from the old team. The number 8 would also be transferred over from DEI, and would be driven part-time by Eric Almirola, while Mark Martin jumped ship to drive full-time for Hendrick. Ironic. And finally, the last remaining Ganassi car. The 42 Target car driven by multi-talent driver, Juan Pablo Montoya. That was it. The 41, gone. The iconic number 40, gone. And in their places were two cars that were the sources of controversy. Ever since Junior left, fans have been shouting release the 8 so Junior can drive his car. And the 1 was a symbol of Dale's legacy that was being held hostage by Teresa. Needless to say, a lot of people were not pleased with this merger. But regardless, 2009 was on the horizon and it was time for the newly rebranded team to shine. They didn't shine. Let's start with the number I'm actually making this video about. The 1 car. Truex finished the year 23rd in points, with only a single top 5 and 6 top 10s, and an average finish of 21.9. Almirola got zeros all across the board in the 8 races he started in, and Earnhardt Ganassi's most successful number was a Ganassi car. Juan Pablo Montoya in the 42 came home with 7 top 5s, 18 top 10s, and an average finish of 14.3. Needless to say, the Earnhardt drivers, they weren't looking too hot. Of course, they probably could have done better, had their boss actually did her job. In an interview with Chip Ganassi on the Dale Jr. Download, Chip claimed that in the 15 minutes he'd been on the show talking to Dale, he had had more interaction with him than he had Teresa in the entirety of the partnership. Teresa just didn't show up. She wasn't at the track with her team like every other owner. She wasn't at the race shop. She wasn't at the meetings. Nothing. The Earnhardt name was only there as a title. No Earnhardt, even if by marriage, was anywhere near the operation. And it's absolutely pathetic because we know why she did this. Greed. It is one thing to deny ownership to the late team owner's sons and daughters, the ones Dale wanted to run DEI. But it's another thing to leave a team running, even if it's on life support, just because you don't want Dale's son to run it. And this is all just out of spite. She's simply in this for the money, and she's using her husband's name as a source of income. She doesn't care about racing. She doesn't care about Dale's legacy or what Dale wanted. All she wants is to put change in her pocket with minimum effort. And the best way to do that is by going against Dale's dying wish. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the Wicked Witch of the South.
Jamie, you're having a great year on the track, man.
Hey, thanks, Kevin. Nice job on the tour.
Hey, you know what we should do the next time we win?
Imitate each other's victory celebrations.
We should do that.
Yeah.
Some big changes were being made at the EGR race shop coming into the 2010 season. Eric Almirola was gone. Along with his departure, the 8 car was finally put out of its misery and shelved, never to be raced with any resemblance to DEI ever again. Martin Truex Jr. saw the writing on the wall and left the team to drive the 56 for Michael Waltrip Racing, a team that was built by a past Earnhardt Incorporated driver who also saw the writing on the wall and left a few years prior. Ironic. In his place was returning Ganassi driver and two-time Cup Series winner Jamie McMurray, which was a match made in heaven. Why? Well, Bass Pro Shops stayed on the 1 car while Martin left for MWR. And Jamie is from Joplin, Missouri, which, if you don't know, is a short drive from Bass Pro's home store in Springfield. And of course, this works great for marketing and merchandise.
Jamie, don't you have a big race today?
Don't worry, Kevin. I got it all covered.
It's Jamie McMurray winning the 2010 Brickyard 400.
How'd we do?
Go where the pros go. For a huge selection of outdoor equipment, head to Bass Pro Shops.
Where's the door handle on this thing?
Kevin, are you sure this is okay?
We're cool. I know a guy.
Hey, y'all.
Run. Go. Run.
Where'd they go?
I was just going to ask them what they were biting on.
But Ganassi and McMurray aren't here to sell fishing poles or bass boats. They're here to win.
get them back. Never mind. Green flag still out. Checkered flag in the air. The 52nd Daytona 500 to Jimmy Valery.
Yes!
Jimmy, baby! The cars that crashed.
What a job by this one team. Jamie McMurray's your winner.
Oh, yeah! Woohoo!
Congratulations, dude. All right.
This was by far the best season the one car has ever had up to this point. 12 top 10s, 9 top 5s, 346 laps led, and 3 wins, two of which that were crown jewel events, the Daytona 500, the Brickyard 400, and the Bank of America 500. But due to being inconsistent, Jamie finished the year 14th in points. When he wasn't winning, he was likely puttering around in the mid-pack, finishing outside of the top 20 11 times. Not something you want to do when competing for a championship. Regardless, 2010 was a solid year for the one car. As long as they could keep the momentum going, no doubt they'll be getting more wins and competing for cup titles. From 2011 to 2018, Jamie McMurray only got a single win in an average finishing position of 16.5. Not the worst run ever, but a far cry from how he did in his first year in the car. In September of 2018, Jamie announced that he would be retiring from full-time racing to focus on TV and broadcasting, leaving the seat of the one car open once again. On a side note, you may have noticed the DEI font is gone. Does that mean... Yep, Teresa has left. She finally got tired of running the team and now owns the DEI Museum, where to this day she continues to threaten innocent people with lawsuits over stuff related to Dale Earnhardt. No, I'm not kidding. So with the seat empty, Ganassi had to quickly find a driver for the 2019 season. And ironically, he would find help from a former team rival. The hot-headed, short-tempered kid from Las Vegas, 2004 Cup Series champion, Kurt Busch.
Number one in town, and I'm taking her to Daytona.
After Dale's passing in 2001, someone else had to wear the black hat in NASCAR, and Kurt Busch fit the bill quite well in the early 2000s, being the center of several on-track antics and brewing up a litany of rivalries, one of the most infamous being with Jimmy Spencer.
Shouldn't race that way, but he won it. I just don't forget, that's all.
Who, for a short period of time during their scuffle, drove the 41 car owned and operated by none other than Chip Ganassi. This back and forth continued throughout 2002, while Jimmy was driving for Ganassi, eventually leading to him wrecking Busch at Indianapolis. In the post-race interview, Kurt returned a favor by calling the veteran a decrepit old has-been. The rivalry continued for the next few years and honestly went too far. In the end though, Jimmy Spencer got the last laugh, because while Kurt got fired from multiple teams and struggled during the Car of Tomorrow era, Spencer retired to TV and broadcasting and got to laugh and poke fun at him as a full-time job.
It's time for Kurt Busch Radio Sweetheart!
Kurt was a good driver, no doubt, but he just couldn't keep himself from doing outlandish stuff on and off the track.
It refrains me from not beating the out of you right now because you asked me stupid questions.
Which all led to him turning to Phoenix Racing when no one else would pick him up, the lowest point of his career. In 2013, Busch announced that he would be driving for Storehouse Racing for the 2014 season in the newly added number 41 car. This was Busch's big comeback. After going winless for 2 years, he would finally score his 25th victory at Martinsville. In 2015, he got 2 wins and ranked 8th in the standings. After this, though, he just couldn't score more than 1 win per year. Sure, he was consistent, but he just could not finish a year with more than 1 win under his belt. It honestly became a running gag amongst NASCAR fans. Oh, here comes Kurt Busch for his 1 win of the year. But all of this was expected to change in 2019.
It's Monster Energy Cup Series Racing. Today's Coke Zero Sugar 400 from Daytona International Speedway.
It's week 18 at Daytona, and it's once again time for the Coke Zero Sugar 400. Despite him not winning a race yet, Kurt Busch is one of the favorites to win today. He qualified inside the top 10 and had a fast-looking car. But like any race of Florida, the big talk wasn't about the race itself, but rather the looming threat of precipitation. After several hours of on and off rain, the Saturday night race was rescheduled to Sunday. However, rain was still in the forecast, but NASCAR decided to just run it until it arrives. Kurt starts in 8th and stays around there for most of the race, but on lap 119, the inevitable happens.
Line as the racing continues, Austin Dillon up front, they shifted him out,
gonna be a big one.
And now around goes the 3 in front of the pack. They're all collected. The 11 with damage, the 22 as well.
Nearly 20 cars are collected, but Kurt Busch manages to squeeze his way through. Now, him and his team have to make a crucial decision. He can stay out and hold his lead, or he can go down pit road and get fresh tires, seeing as how his are about used up. But that threat of rain is still hanging above them. If he ducks down pit road and they call the race due to weather, it's over. It's a risky move, but Kurt's crew chief feels sure it's going to hold off. So he gives up the lead to the 77 of Justin Haley to get fresh Goodyears. But just as the race is about to go green, lightning. NASCAR has a rule that if lightning is detected anywhere within an 8-mile radius of the track, all cars must come down pit road while holding their positions and wait 30 minutes for the all clear. That way none of the spectators get killed or injured like what happened in Pocono in 2012. But if another strike occurs, the timer is reset. And on this day, the storm just doesn't want the race to end under green. So after 2 hours of waiting, NASCAR calls it. Justin Haley, your Coke Zero Sugar 400 winner, while Kurt Busch settles for a 10th place finish. The one team left Daytona, soaking wet and heads low from a yet another near W. It wasn't like they weren't trying. Heck, they already had 2 runner-up finishes, and were very consistent all year long up to that point. But no matter how hard they drove, the one team and Kurt Busch just couldn't get a win. However, there was always next week. There was a different feeling in the air at week 19 in Kentucky. I would know, because I was there. Despite the track being on the chopping block, this day in particular sees a fairly good sized crowd. Everyone is anticipating a good race, but no one expects it to go the way it does. Daniel Suarez sat on the pole and would lead 52 laps, but was soon overrun by our antagonist for this story. That being, Kyle Busch, Kurt's younger brother. Now here's the thing, in 2019, I did not like Kyle Busch. Most of the sport as well hated this guy. Aside from him being a snotty little brat, it seemed like between him and Jimmy Johnson that he was winning every single week. I mean, he is the winningest driver of the decade. And right now, he's en route to his second championship with 5 wins on the season under his belt. So after months of anticipating this race, I sit back and wait for the inevitable. I'm gonna have to watch Kyle Busch drive off with a win in person again. This will be the third time this has happened. But, hold on, something is stirring behind him. And that stir is a matte black number one car driven by Crybaby Bush's older brother, Kurt Busch. Was this the closest finish in NASCAR history? No. Was the race overall forgetful? Yes. Was it enough to save Kentucky Speedway? No, but this was a landmark moment in Kurt Busch's career. Not only had he gained his 31st career victory, but he had also earned the one car's first win since Jamie McMurray won at Sonoma in 2013, shattering a 6-year losing streak. Thanks to this win, Kurt proved that he belonged in the one car and would stay with Chip Ganassi for years to come.
This NASCAR season might just be the greatest season of all time, like ever. A new team from North Carolina is joining the race.
We're all here for one reason and one reason only.
All I'm saying is this might be the best season ever.
2021 was a stepping stone for a lot of changes in the sport, a couple of those being new teams in the roster. 2311, a team co-owned by Denny Hamlin and NBA legend Michael Jordan, fielding the 23 driven by Bubba Wallace. And Trackhouse, fielding the revised 99 driven by Daniel Suarez, co-owned by Justin Marks and Pitbull. Yes, Mr. Worldwide himself. Before the season was even halfway over, both organizations were under discussion about expanding to two car operations. 2311 had already started development for a 45 car, while Trackhouse...
It's time for the Daily Fuel. The big announcement today for Trackhouse Racing, announcing the acquisition of Chip Ganassi Racing. So Justin Marks and Chip were on hand at the NASCAR Hall of Fame for the announcement earlier today.
Trackhouse Entertainment Group and Trackhouse Racing has purchased the NASCAR operation of Chip Ganassi Racing. Trackhouse has acquired all of the NASCAR assets of Ganassi Racing, including all the equipment and its two charters.
On June 30th, Chip Ganassi announced that his operation was sold to Trackhouse. This wasn't a merger like the EGR thing back in 08. No, this was a buyout of CGR's entire Cup Series team, meaning at the start of the 2022 season, there wouldn't be any Chip Ganassi-owned cars in NASCAR. And with Trackhouse under control, the team was going to see a major overhaul. The 42, the last remaining full-time Ganassi car after the DEI merger, was axed, replaced by Trackhouse's own 99. As for the 1, it stayed, being rebranded for the second time in its 25 years on the roster. But who's going to drive it? Well, obviously it's going to be Kurt Busch.
Thought I was leaving. Racing for 2311? Are you kidding me? It's Michael Jordan, Denny Hamlin, Toyota. There's more winning to be done.
Okay, never mind. Just less than 2 months later, Kurt announced that he'd be leaving to drive the 45 for 2311. Meaning that after 2021, the one car would be vacant again. Trackhouse had to find a replacement quickly, and it couldn't just be any mid-packer. They needed someone who would give 100% and was willing to do anything to win for the new organization. Thankfully, they wouldn't have to look far.
Only three drivers that were winless, and now he's slow on the track to five right up behind him. Smoke coming out from Larson. Larson up against the wall. It's a drag race to the checkered flag. Denny Hamlin's gonna win it.
Aside from Ricky Craven's win back in 2003, this was one of the greatest finishes in all of Darlington history. Kyle Larson rode the wall trying to pass Denny Hamlin for the lead, but failed. Joke's on him though, because Larson would win the championship after putting together a dominating season. But that's not what we're here to talk about. Nah, I want to talk about the guy in third. The one watching this from about 2 seconds back driving the 42 Ganassi car. Not a lot of folks know him at this point. In fact, the most he's known for is actually being the replacement for the guy in second, after some mild controversy.
I can see it. You can't hear me?
Unbeknownst to everyone, this was his best finish in the NASCAR Cup Series up to this point, and it was only his first full-time year. Of course, he could have been in the series earlier, but his road has been a struggle. Now though, he's driving in good equipment and is about to be dropped into one of the most legendary numbers in NASCAR. And his name is...
Sun went down and the jungle fire was burning. Down the track came a hobo hiking, and he said, "Boys, I'm not turning."
Most of today's drivers could tell you the same story of the origins of their racing career. Born into a racing family, or their father had the money and business know-how to get them to where they are today. That wasn't the case for Ross Chastain. Ross was born into a family watermelon farm of seven generations in Alva, Florida, and was expected to carry on that tradition. That is, until he got the itch for racing. Ross's father was a full-time farmer, but he did race as a hobby. Not to put food on the table, just to satisfy his need for speed. Ross saw this, and at age 12 made the decision that he wanted to chase a career in racing, which to many was labeled as an unattainable pipe dream, but he was determined to do so. 6 years later, in 2011, Ross made his first start ever in a NASCAR-sanctioned race at Indianapolis Raceway Park in the number 66 Chevy Silverado. That same race, he'd score his first top 10, allowing him the opportunity to drive the truck three more times that season, where he only got one DNQ. Not a bad start at all. Just the next season, he would be promoted to a full-time ride in the 08 Toyota, and by 2014, he was already making starts in the Xfinity Series. He spent 2015, 16, and 17 driving for JD Motorsports. But halfway through the 2018 season, he left to drive for Ganassi's Xfinity Series program. As soon as he's dropped into the 42 DC Solar car, his talent starts showing. His first race at Darlington, he wins the pole. The next race at Indianapolis, he finishes just outside of the top 10. And the next week at Las Vegas, he gets his first ever NASCAR win. Ganassi offers Ross a full-time ride in the 42 for 2019, which he says could eventually lead to a full-time ride in the Cup Series. But that wouldn't happen yet. Jeff Karpov, the CEO of DC Solar, had his home raided by the FBI on December of 2018 for allegations of Ponzi schemes associated with the company. This was Ganassi's biggest sponsor in the Xfinity Series. And as a result, just a few days later, their operation was shut down. Ross would now have to team jump all of 2019, but he would find success again in 2020 while driving the 10 for Colleg Racing, scoring 15 top 5s, 27 top 10s, and finishing the year 7th in the points standings. But in 2021, Ross would get his big break. After Kyle Larson was removed from the 42 in 2020, Matt Kenseth temporarily came out of retirement to sub, but Ganassi needed a full-time driver for 2021, and that's where Ross Chastain comes in. Ross finished his first full-time year in the Cup Series with 3 top 5s and 8 top 10s. A solid start, but nothing compared to how he'd do in the one car.
Hello, I'm Alex Weaver with breaking news in the NASCAR Cup Series. Trackhouse Racing has announced that Ross Chastain will be signing on as the second driver for the team in 2022. Chastain will become teammates with Trackhouse Racing's current driver, Daniel Suarez, next season.
In his first year in the one car, Ross Chastain brought it home with 15 top 5s, 21 top...
Why are you pulling me? I'm right!
Alright, fair enough. We'll just skip straight to the part that you're all here for. I want you to ask yourself a question. If Dale Earnhardt had raced in NASCAR's current points format, what would his championship runs look like? Dale was already pretty well known for bending the rules to get his way, but how would that performance change in a playoff format? Well, as much as people may disagree, I don't think we have to imagine, because we've already seen someone do it. And in the old DEI number one, no less. He may not be Dale Earnhardt, but Ross Chastain is no doubt carrying on his legacy. But I can hear the casual audience. What led to this? Why was this such a big deal? Well, as controversial as it may be to the diehard NASCAR fans, this moment probably wouldn't exist had it not been for the NASCAR playoffs. The NASCAR playoff format was originally introduced in 2004 as the Chase for the Cup, and has been reworked seemingly dozens of times in its 20 years. But the modern playoff format we know today was introduced in 2014. NASCAR now runs off a bracket, but instead of teams fighting each other throughout the week, all 40 competitors gather up in one venue and fight for this once a week. By the time we reach the last 10 weeks of the season, the points for the top 16 of the regular season are reset, the top 16 being the best of the regular season, or you can also take advantage of the win in your end system. Now here's the thing, Ross is currently having the season of his life. He'll end it with 15 top 5s, 21 top 10s, and 2 wins. But those didn't come easy. En route to his best season ever, he's made some enemies. One of those being previously mentioned driver, Denny Hamlin.
Ross has been all over the back of Denny, and he finally just runs into him.
He definitely moved him. Probably frustration. He was door-to-door with him a lot of times, got under him several times, could not make the pass. He finally made the pass.
He might be.
Here we go.
Oh! Out there on your tight, really tight.
Oh!
Thankfully, during the majority of the playoffs, Ross has remained consistent, leaving him out of a must-win situation. But after week 34 at Homestead, it's time to head to Martinsville for the final cutoff race of the season. What does that mean? Remember the bracket? You may have noticed it gets smaller as the playoffs go on, similar to one in any sport. That means every few weeks, NASCAR hosts a cutoff race. If you're not in a must-win situation but fail to finish ahead of the other playoff competitors, you don't advance to the next round. Right now, Martinsville is the stage for the cutoff that will determine the final four, meaning only four competitors will be eligible for the championship in the final round of the playoffs. Look, if this is confusing, just bear with me. I'm a NASCAR fan, and only recently did I start to understand it. There's people on this platform that can explain it way better than I can. Thankfully, Ross is not in a must-win situation, but Martinsville is not an easy track to navigate, especially in a pack of 40 cars. And unfortunately, the guy he needs to beat to advance to the final round is none other than his old rival, Denny Hamlin.
Ross Chastain trying to get by the 9. Again, that points battle to determine who is the final championship four driver. Now Bell pulling away with those pressure tires.
You need the 9 right here, Ram.
Keselowski way up the racetrack. Briscoe on the outside 3 wide. His championship hopes starting to falter.
As Briscoe falls back through the field, though, that's another spot for Denny potentially. You see Denny right there.
They're tied again. The tiebreaker goes to Chastain. Coming up on 2 to go.
Denny knocks the 24 up the racetrack. Chastain doesn't have anybody in front of him to go past. He's too far away from everybody.
As the laps wound down, it was apparent that Ross Chastain was slower than he needed to be. By the time the race reached 2 to go, it was clear that he wasn't going to advance. Denny Hamlin was seconds ahead, nearly half the track's length. It seemed as if Denny was going to easily coast to a final four spot as his teammate won his way in. But Ross, he had shown all year his determination to win, going as far to blatantly break rules and bend them to his will. And right now, going into turn 3 on the last lap, he sees an opportunity. An opportunity to bring the one car, Dale's car, to its formal thought glory. The one it never had before. Marred by injuries, heartbreak, lawsuits, mergers, and buyouts. All of which kept the car from being what Dale wanted it to be. And for the first time ever, it had the driver to do what Dale had envisioned when creating the DEI-1 car nearly 25 years ago.
You made the transfer, man! That was f***ing ridiculous, dude! That was wild!